Now's a good time to talk about whatever you want to talk about. So there's a question. Does the cat example module have a custom decorator service? I realized I didn't do a decorator in that module, but I do have other modules that have decorator services in them. Yes, we can, and I can also point you to a really good blog post on that. It's by someone I found one time, but yeah, we can start looking at examples. Let me give another few minutes in case people can think of questions or have something that pops up. But then we'll start looking at the other examples I have in code. And we can look at the Cat API module code. We can look at that in a more fully formed way without the limitations of this slideshow presentation. Yeah, review the syntax of public function construct. Sure, I can do that. Let's take a look at code. Here we go. Can everybody see what looks like PHP Storm? Or can anyone see it? I really just need one of you to say that you see it. Okay, great. So let's start with Yes. Okay. So I got a couple questions here. We want to look at custom decorator services. We want to look at the construction syntax for classes, and we're going to look at how we get the Cat API client on dependency injections. So let's just start with constructors. So I'm just going to drop a new file in here. Let's see. We don't want to call it my class because that's always terrible to name it the name of your example. I'm gonna make a new model. So I don't have this yet. I'm gonna make a new data object. I'm gonna call it a module, and this is gonna be a cat, which I actually don't have. I don't think this is gonna be called a cat breed because this is something that my API deals with. I'll worry about that later. So I'm just going to write out the sort of the basics of this model real quick, and we will look at the constructor and we'll look at the website as well. So and really what this should do, is that code legible? Is this too small? Really, what we should do is we need a cat breed interface if we're going to really use this thing. So I'll come back to that. But so I've got a cat called, and this is mainly as an example. I've got this class called cat breed, and it needs, when it is first being instantiated, it has some, it needs to receive some data from the system. So for example, a cat breed probably has a name. Let's keep these things private for now. Probably has a name and a description and something else that a cat breed probably has. Temperament. I think that's one I saw in the API. Temperament. That's probably definitely how you spell it. Temperament, temperament. I don't know. Oh, missing the. I'm just gonna.
T-E-M,
Thank you. Temperament.
not T-E-R.
Oh, thanks. All right. There we go. Thank you. Appreciate it. So, what we need to do is get this data into the object somehow. And that's generally done through passing some data in through some method. The construct method on a, in PHP is what's called a magic method. It is the method that is run when a class is first instantiated. So if I'm going to later encode, this is totally later. If I'm going to later make an instance of a cat breed, like a, I actually don't know any cat breeds, so we're just going to call this some breed equals new cat breed. So later in the code, I'm going to instantiate this thing, and I got to get my, I got to populate this data object somehow. And so when I'm instantiating the cat breed, what PHP does is immediately runs this constructor method. So there's a number of PHP methods that start with two underscores, underscore, underscore, construct. And the terminology for that is generally like a magic method. But for the sake of this, it's not important to know that it's magic, just that whenever I do this, this method is automatically run. Maybe that is magic. So if I want to say that the name of this breed, so I want to populate this thing so I can tell the constructor that when this thing is very first instantiated, it needs a bunch of data to start with. So it's got the name, description, and temperament. And I can run, and then I'll set the values on this class equal to whatever was passed into the constructor. So like this. Okay. So now when I run this code right here, the constructor is immediately called. But if I ran this code right here, since I didn't pass any parameters, this would fatally error. Actually, we can show this. Where am I? Oh, it's called Drupal. Cat API. Why am I bad at this? Oh, it's because I've got so many nested folders. Here we are. Cat API, source, model. Okay. So let's just clear this out. If I run PHP on this file, fatal error, because I tried to instantiate a instance of the cat breed class, and PHP immediately ran its constructor. And so, and I didn't provide any values into the constructor. So that's a fatal error. So the way you use a constructor is you define things that must exist for an instance of this object to be usable, like the fundamentals of the object. And by defining those fundamentals or the requirements or dependencies of the object as parameters on the constructor, you're saying that the values for those things must exist at the time of instantiation, or else there is something fatally wrong with this program. So now that I've passed in just any old thing in here, I instantiated a new instance of this class cat breed, and I fulfilled the requirements of the constructor, and so everything's fine. No problems here. Does that help, John? The syntax there, or the how the constructor works? And syntax wise, it is public, because it's good practice to write out this visibility word. If you don't write a visibility word on a method, it defaults to public. So this right here is still public. There's nothing wrong with it. And if you really want to mess with people, you can set your constructors to private. And there's basically no reason to ever do that. It means that your class cannot be constructed by some other part of the system. But I don't mean to show that as something to think about and do. I mean to show that to explain why the constructor is public. All right. So let's look at how we got the CAT API client on the dependency injections for containers. And then we'll come back to a module with custom decorator services. So I'm just going to go ahead and we'll leave this here. I'm not using this model at all, but who knows? We might want it later. So we've got our CAT API module, and it defines a bunch of services. And the first part of a service definition is whatever I want to name my new service I'm creating. So in this case, I chose to name this CAT API Client Factory, and what the CAT API Client Factory is an instance of this class. So I could open that up. It's an instance of this class, which just got it's very similar to what we looked at in the slides, but it has a lot more code comments, and it's properly type hinted everywhere. So, and I've got this other service called catapi.client because that's what I chose to name it. No, there's no magic between what we choose to name a service and the service's any other part of the service. It's class, nothing like that matters at all. So it's called CAT API client service or CAT API client because I wanted it to be. But I think the question is really more about like, how do we know how to get it, or how does it work when we start injecting this service from the container? So the container, as we looked at the service locator example earlier, let me go to Scratch here. So a service locator or container, I'm just going to call it a container. We know it's the same thing. This is what it looks like. It's got an array here, and it's got a get method. And that get method just returns the instance. And I mean, I guess it has an add method too, just so that this makes sense. This was shown earlier. It's just a little easier to type it out than it would be to go find that slide. So, okay. So keep this in mind when we're looking at that services.yaml file. So when Drupal is building the container, or it's building, it's sort of like plan for the container, it caches this, it's services, then whatever I chose to name my new service, CAT API client, is what is passed into this service locator. So somewhere along the way, Drupal is like, I got this new container. I'm going to populate it. Nope, not controller, but container. Obviously this one. I don't know what your deal is. So Drupal is building this container from the services YAML. So it's like load the services YAML and then loop through every service defined in this YAML and run container add on whatever its name is. So the reason CAT API client from the container is because I named it that. And by naming it that, it became the key for this service in the services array inside of the container. So I don't know if that's, let's just do this. Here we go. So I think that's that might help in sort of mentally picturing like where this thing is. Where is this thing? Well, it's in this array. And how is it in this array? Well, it's in this array keyed by its name, like this. Okay, so there it is. It's in the container keyed by its name. Let me make this not wild. And so now we can we can make use of it later. Now we need to talk about how a how another part of the system gets that data. Oh, does that make sense? Did I answer your question already? The question about how we know what to call it. It looks, I saw
yes, a yes. Yeah, I get in that.
Okay. Okay, great. Awesome. Cool. All right. So the other question that's here is, can we look at an example of a service decorator? Yes, we can. We can't in this cat API module, but that's okay. We can in this cleverly named module called services examples that I wrote at one point. So services examples, let's go to Drupal and let's do services examples. I'm going to go ahead and enable this so we can see what it does. So services examples as a module implements or provides a number of services, and all of these services do one thing, just to keep the concept of the example simple. They're all password generator services. So if you think about like a LastPass or I don't know, any of those other hundreds of tools that generate passwords for you, that's what these all of these services do. And they're all just different examples of using services in Drupal, or rather in Symfony. So let's see here. What do we have? I think what I did to set myself up for success here is I gave myself a link to the quote configure page, which isn't true. It's actually a link to the to a sandbox where we can play with this. So I've got a number of services here, and one is a very simple password generator. Another is an abstract password generator, which is meant to as a base for other services. It's not meant to be instantiated itself. You can't instantiate it, but that's not the point of the question. I've got a cryptographically secure password generator, which is also not the point of the question, but this is showing service inheritance. You can define inheritance in your like your inheritance hierarchy in service files. And this is an example of that, but that's not the point. But it does explain why we get to this unambiguous password generator. And it's got a, it also inherits from the abstract password generator. So long story short, we're going to skip all the way down to this unambiguous password generator. We're going to start with, actually, let's build up on this so that we have a full picture. Basically, I'm showing you what we're going to decorate, and then we'll decorate it. That way we have a full picture of what's going on here. So abstract base. Yep. Okay. So we're going to start with the abstract base. What we have here is our password generator class that is an abstract class. That means that this class cannot be instantiated. It must be inherited, and only its descendants can be instantiated. And this defines a couple of methods here, but the main one is generate a password. It's got generate a password. It's got a means of generating a random number. It's got character sets divided up by numbers and uppercase and lowercase. These are all the parts of a password generator. So this is our abstract, and one descendant, the immediate descendant of this that we care about is our unambiguous password generator. So all of this does as a class is it changes the character sets of the parent class. So it removes like a one because a one looks like an L, and it removes a lowercase L because lowercase L's look like ones. And it removes zeros and the letter O. So that's it. That's the only thing this version of the service does is removes the ambiguous characters from the character set. So we've got a password generator. That was the point of all of that stuff. And now we want to make another, we want to do something a little different. So this is, these are randomly generated passwords. So we decide that we want our unambiguous. Let's see what our decorator does. It's been a while since I look at this. Oh, okay. We've defined a decorator, a new service that's going to be a decorator service. And all I wanted this to do was to basically set a message in Drupal to prove that we decorated the service. Okay. So what this unambiguous decoration does is it decorates this other service. Public is set to false so that no part of the system can actually reach out and get the decoration alone. What will happen is when something requests the unambiguous service, it will automatically be returned decorated. So the arguments of our decorators, meaning the dependencies of our decorators, are always this pattern in Symfony 4, which is itself as a pattern as a service name. Note the at symbol at the beginning, and then dot enter. And so when the service container builds the unambiguous password generator, it then passes it into the unambiguous decoration, and the unambiguous decoration saves that password generator as just a property on itself, just needs to keep up with itself. And then it overrides the parts of the service it provides methods for the parts of the service that it is decorating that it wants to deal with. So in this case, whenever someone runs generate password, it's going to add a Drupal message. So I didn't inject the messenger, my bad, but that is what our decoration is going to do. It's really just a proof. So if I refresh this page, we can see that this thing has been, there's a message set here called this message provided by the decoration on Drupal password generator and ambiguous. Even though the original service was requested, the container smartly returned an instance of the decoration. If a service is decorated multiple times, the decoration with the highest priority goes first. So that's just a long-winded way of saying, like, yep, this definitely happened. And there is that big long-winded sentence there. So what did it do? Well, it took over the generated password function and then it did my little message thing that I wanted. I altered the behavior of that function or that method. And then I just ran the original inner services generate password. So that is how I decorated the service, but it doesn't actually touch on some of the problems that you have to deal with when decorating services, because this is a pretty simple example. But now we're ready to talk about that part of the problem, if you'd like. So let's look at the controller where we are playing around with this. So in the controller, I don't know why I can't find things, but that I don't care much right now. So in the controller, I told this the controller, which is what handles this page route, this controller here handles that page that we're seeing. I said that it should implement the container injection interface. It does that through the controller base. You see the controller base implements that. So that was enough for me. And in doing so, that means that I can have a factory method on this controller and I get the container from it during the factory method. So somebody visits this page, Drupal's like, I got to build that page. I see that you have a create method. Let me run that. And then I go get all the services that I want from the container by name. Note that I got the unambiguous service. I did not get the service named unambiguous decoration. So I requested this one, but what I got from the service container was this one fully decorated with every other version of with every decorator applied to it, which means what the actual class that I got back was whatever is the highest priority. Decorator, I think, is highest priority. So then we go down here, and all this page does is it just runs password generate password on all of these different services. So the reason that this is sort of too simple of an example to explain the problems of, or the challenges rather, of service decorators is that a password generator only has one method. So every decorator only has to deal with one thing. If you're decorating this, then what you want to the behavior you want to modify is generate password. So that's sort of the problem. That I need to create a problem so I can show you how it can be solved. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to define another method on here. And it doesn't matter what it is, but so I've defined another part of our contract, the interface, that means that every one of my password generators now has to implement this method, or else it'll be fundamentally broken. So I think if I go to the abstract base, what are we going to find? Well, the abstract base isn't going to care. It's abstract. It can't be instantiated anyway. But now we've got this password unambiguous that is, let's see if that one broke too. No, great. Okay. So unambiguous, the main service, it has to implement that. So let's go ahead and do that. Doesn't matter what it does right now. And then the password generator unambiguous decoration also has to implement it. So I have this decoration that what I really want to do is modify the behavior of one method. But what if it's decorating something that implements like 50 other methods? Then suddenly I'm in this position where my decorator has to write a whole bunch of code like this, just to make sure that if my decorator is supplied back from the service, that it doesn't break everybody else's code. So that is the challenge with service decorators, is that when you make a service decorator, it must provide functionality for everything that it is decorating. All right. So what do we do? Let's imagine that this does have 50 methods. We're going to imagine it a little practically, but I won't take too long. All right. Wow. Look at all that stuff we have to worry about that my decorator doesn't care at all about. So there's a workaround to this problem, and I don't love it, but also it's probably fine. And that's basically whenever you're doing a service decorator, to write a magic call function. So the magic call function, I think it's like arguments. I might have to look this up. See what that gives me. Now, give me 1 second. Let's just make sure this is right, so we're not like sharing bad information. All right. Garfield, what's that guy's? What method and arguments? Yep, that sounds right to me. Making sure I'm understanding this right. I mean, he does contribute to all of PHP, so I probably can trust that. Okay. Let's do one more. Reference from the documentation. Magic call expects name and arguments. Okay, we got it. So this workaround from having to implement all of this other functionality when actually my decorator doesn't care about it at all is to write a magic call method on my decorator. And in this method, what I'm going to do is I'm going to run call user func array on this service, and the user func I'm going to call is method, and I'm going to pass in these arguments. So what this did is, first of all, I implemented magic in PHP, and what that means is if some other parts of the system, well, I changed the interface. Give me one. So I'm getting a red line up here, but that's not the point. So let's get rid of that. So if some other parts of the system that has a copy of this class, an instance of this class, tries to run a method on this class that's not defined, PHP says, like, well, that method doesn't exist, but hey, look, this call magic method does. So I'll just pass whatever was requested into it instead. And so what this little workaround does is says, like, whenever something calls on this class a method that this class doesn't have, instead go ahead and call that on the inner service, the thing that's being decorated. And so let's make this really silly. All right. So I'm actually gonna run this and see what happens. So I've noticed I've not defined a method on this decorator called another three. I think that's the one I used there. Yep, I have not. And then I'm gonna go to my little sandbox here, and I'm gonna run this unambiguous another. It doesn't know this exists, but that's okay. So another three. So what's gonna happen is this is actually an instance of my decorator class. And my decorator class says, I don't have a method called another three. So better just go ahead and pass that along to the thing I'm decorating, the inner service. And then the inner service is like, I've got something called another three. I'm just going to die and echo out this information, whatever the name of the method is. So now theoretically, if I go and refresh this page, we're gonna get the name of that inner service and the name of the method that was run. And so, yeah, that is a lot of words that are basically driving to the point of this little approach right here is a workaround for decorating very complex services without having to re-implement every single method that is on the service, when really what you want to do in ideally decorators each do one discrete thing. They're responsible for one change of behavior. I guess you could do more, whatever. But what you really want to do is you want to implement one specific behavior, change it, then make sure that if the inner service needs to do more work, then go ahead and let the inner service do more work. Otherwise, just let the inner service do everything. Does that make sense? Does that answer your question? Or does that help explain some of the challenge, like a workaround to the challenge of service decorators? Cool. All right. So let's see, for the Guzzlecat service, does it use Drupal cron to fetch data, or does it work independently? Oh, actually, it's really straightforward. It doesn't use anything fancy at all. Basically, all it does, let's just get rid of that. All it does is on each request, let's go look at some cats. Can't see. All right, let's go look at cats. So I have a controller here at browse cats, at the path browse cats. And let's go look at the code for that. I'm gonna go get rid of this password generator stuff. And instead I'm gonna go into the cat API module. And I've got a routing file with a couple of different
routes. Are we in discussion time? I had to step out.
Oh yeah, we can talk about whatever. I'm going through some cat stuff. Yeah, do you have a question?
My audio must be off.
Oh. Yes. All right. So I've got this Browse Cats page, and basically it's set up to where if somebody visits this page, to pass it to this controller. And I've got that controller. So bloop, bloop, bloop. And this controller gets all of its dependencies injected because it implemented the container injection interface. And therefore, when the controller is first requested and Drupal has to instantiate it, it instantiates it using this method factory. And therefore, I have access to the container and I can get whatever I want out of the container. And then in my page function, I have the cat API client, and I just call it every single time the page gets hit. To answer your question, no, I'm not using cron. I'm not caching anything. There's nothing automated at all about this example. It's really every single time we hit this page, it makes a new request to that API. And I've got the route set up to where we can click through and look at a cat breed, get some more information. Temperament, there it is. And yeah, that's all the cat breeds endpoint does. By the way, if anybody has another question, please ask, because I'm just going to start looking at cats if you don't tell me otherwise. I think I've got some more.
I missed the part where you might have explained what a plugin is.
Oh, I didn't go into what a plugin is, but I did talk about how to use dependency injection with a plugin. I can talk about what a plugin is a little bit, but I think you might rather, I can't see what I'm typing here. Am I typing Drupal Camp Florida? Drupal.camp. There we go. There is a session tomorrow that I think is all about plugins. Let's see.
Does it have a meaning that fits into this object-oriented terminology?
Oh no, it's a Drupalism. So in Drupal, plugin has a meaning. In PHP broadly, plugin does not have a meaning.
All right.
So in Drupal, what a plugin is it's a way to add new functionality to different parts of Drupal. So for example, if we look at the block page. So if we look at the block page, we can add blocks anywhere throughout to any of our regions. And I click to place a block. I have a list of all of these different blocks that are available. Each of these types of blocks, let me take one step back just to make sure this is clear. So I can place blocks, instances of a type of block, multiple times in Drupal 8. So I just placed a cat API random cat. I can place another cat API random cat. And so what we're looking at in this big list of blocks aren't individual blocks. These are types of blocks. So in Drupal, a type of a block is a plugin. This generic concept in Drupal called a plugin. Plugins share, there are other types of plugins. There are many types of plugins in Drupal, and they share some common attributes, but generally they don't have to be similar in any way. So like a block is a plugin. If you were to write a custom block typing code, you would be writing a new plugin in Drupal. And also if we go look at content types, so you're still middle clicking everything in fields, and we look at like a display. Let's look at like a field display. So the way a field displays the formatter in Drupal, that is a plugin. It's a type of plugin. So plugins are all over the place. Even like the way a field displays on the form is a plugin in Drupal, and even a field type itself is a plugin in Drupal. Plugin just means it's just a word they chose for this type of extension to Drupal 8. A module may have lots of plugins in it. Does that help?
Yes, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I remembered seeing this come through the email, so I think it's worthwhile. Plugins are very, very cool, especially as a, I find them to be very exciting as a Drupal 8 module developer, because before plugins, Drupal 7 and previous just passed around a bunch of associative arrays. Like if anybody's worked in Drupal 7 or previous, then you might have done like a hook entity info alter or one of those hooks where basically what you're doing is you're just modifying an associative array. Well, that concept, that sort of information registry concept has been replaced in Drupal, thankfully, with plugin systems, various different types of plugins. So if you ever wrote a custom block in Drupal, a block type in Drupal 7, you wrote it by implementing hook block info or something like that, and you returned an associative array with like some details about what your new block type was going to be about. But in Drupal, we don't do that anymore. And say instead we have a plugin system that is meant to handle blocks for us. So I can look at a custom block. So what makes this block a plugin is a number of things. But the important attributes of a plugin in Drupal are two or three things. One, it implements a specific type of metadata called an annotation. It implements a specific type with specific values. So this information that looks like it's just a code comment is actually telling Drupal that this class is a block type. And that is called an annotation. Two, the path of where you put it in your module is very important. So if I were to move this block type outside of this folder, no, it's in the plugin folder in the block folder. If I were to move this class somewhere else, Drupal would never find this custom plugin. And that's because the system that goes throughout all the modules detecting custom blocks expects it to exist in that module's plugin block folder. And if it's not in that folder, too bad. It'll never find it. And then to sort of help out with that, you've got this like block base, which really is an abstract class, but really what it is a context aware plugin base, which is another abstract class. And we are like, you want to see inheritance? You guys know, I don't see a lot of inheritance. So we get all the way down to plugin base. So all of these are just sort of like helper abstract classes that ultimately build up to where when we're defining a new block plugin type, we can do it relatively simply. So that is more than you asked about blocks and plugins. Hope that was helpful. Does anybody else have anything they want to talk about? Let's see if I've got anything else. See if there's any promises I made in this presentation description that are undelivered upon. And also we can just go. We don't have to keep drag this out until 5 p.m. Let's just see here. All right. We talked about nouns and verbs, composition over inheritance, dependency injection, programming interfaces, cohesion and coupling. We can talk about that a little bit, but we've really hit on coupling a lot. Dependency injection container versus the service locator. That's the same idea, different usage. Events, we haven't said versus hook, but the factory pattern, the decorator pattern. We've talked about dependency injection in services, forms, blocks, and controllers. So yeah, I think this is pretty good. Is there anything somebody wants to talk about, or should we call it a day? All right. I don't even think I have a thank you slide, so I'm just going to say thanks a lot, y'all.
Thanks, that was great.
Thanks so much.
Awesome. Yeah, I will. If I have your email already, you would have received an email last night from me, and I will send out a link to the slides and a way to download the video if you'd like. If you didn't receive an email from me yesterday, then please go ahead and email me, jonathan@daggerheart.com. That looks a lot like, here, let me cheat. I can't see. There we go. So email me, jonathan@daggerheart.com, spelled like this, but with an at and a .com. And I will make sure to include you on that email I send out with the slides and the link to the video. All right, y'all. Well, thanks a lot. Y'all have a great rest of your day and stay safe and warm. Bye, y'all.